Doing mathematics today is conducting a technological orchestra with all of the skills that requires and all of the creativity that involves and all of the fun that entails.
Keith, welcome. Thank you so much for being here today with us.
Thank you for the invitation.
Keith, you have such a polymath because you are a mathematician,
yeah.
You are a researcher, you are a science popularizer. So I would like to start from the very beginning.
Yeah.
And it's about your passion for maths. Is this something, maths, it's something that has always captured you, or there was a moment in your life when you fall in love with maths?
Oh, there was a definite moment, yes. I had a moment of just revelation. What got me into it first, it was science. I was about to go from the elementary school to the middle high school in the UK, the year that Sputnik went up. And you know, I was a young kid growing up in post-war England. It was mostly reading. There was very little television, radio reading, but I liked science fiction. It was just one of the genres that I really liked. I was an avid reader and really excited about science fiction stories. And then all of a sudden, science fiction became science fact. There was a rocket gone up and there was a satellite going around the Earth. And that just sort of completely excited me. I said, I've just got to get into this. I was 10 years old, but that was what I wanted to do. So I knew that I had to go. When I got to high school, I was going to learn physics, because physics was what got you into space. I wanted to be part of that. Actually, I wanted to be an astronaut or whatever I thought was going to happen, but I knew I had to become some kind of a scientist. So physics was what I wanted to do. So I went to high school, but I discovered you'd actually need to know quite a bit of mathematics to do physics. And I wasn't good at mathematics. In the elementary school, I was the last kid to learn my multiplication tables. So I suddenly started putting a lot of effort into learning the mathematics in order to get into physics, in order to get into been an astronaut or something like that. I didn't like the math. It didn't make sense to me, but I learned how to play the game, to follow the rules, to do the calculations. And in the end, I was getting really good grades. But then when I was 16 years of age and getting into sort of advanced mathematics in particular, I met this thing called calculus. Now, calculus is where kids that survive algebra finally drop off. So most of my friends dropped off at calculus. For me, that was when I got interested in mathematics. It was interesting, it was exciting, it was clearly the mathematics for space exploration. It was all about planetary motion, satellite motion. So calculus was where it was at for someone with my interests. So then when I learned that it was invented by Isaac Newton when he was 19 years old, only 3 years older than me, I just thought, there was an Englishman back a few hundred years ago that invented calculus. I should be able to understand this stuff. And then I really went at it. And in the process of going at it between the ages of 16 and 18, when I left to go to university, mathematics all fell into place. It was no longer a collection of disjointed techniques and tricks and facts you have to learn in order to solve problems. It all fell together like a jigsaw suddenly landing on the floor in the right order. And you could see the picture. And I could see this picture of mathematics. And it blew me away. It was one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. It was a revelation, and that was all I wanted to do. Physics just fell out of the door immediately. I didn't want to become a physicist, didn't want to become an astronaut. I wanted to learn about a much more exciting world. Outer space was exciting. This world of abstract mathematics, which was a whole universe of its own, that was what I wanted to explore. So from the age of 16, 17 onwards, all I wanted to do was mathematics. And I went to university, King's College London, studying purely mathematics.
Keith, did you have a mentor or someone who helped you nurture this love for maths, or is it something that you did on your own?
The main mentors were actually writers of popular books, which is why I ended up spending a lot of effort writing popular books. What made me make the transition were books by people like Warwick Sawyer, in particular W.W. Sawyer, who wrote English language, he's Canadian, he wrote English language books on popularizing mathematics. There were some classics by Lancelot Hogben and various other people. So I read popularizations of mathematics, and that was really the guidance for me to understand what was going on. I was fortunate that I had two teachers in the upper levels of high school, the last 2 years when we're doing A-levels in the UK, one for pure mathematics, one for applied mathematics, because I was excited about it, I was racing ahead, and the rest of the students were struggling because they didn't like calculus mostly. Potentially I was sort of disruptive. I mean, I wasn't a nuisance, but I was so far ahead that they said, we don't want you in the classroom. We're going to sit you in the dining room, the school dining room in the corner. You can use our college textbooks. We'll come in from time to time and talk to you. We can talk to you afterwards. But basically, we want you to teach yourself from our college textbooks. At the end of the first year, I was asking them questions and they were saying, I never really understood this as a student, but here's the best I can do. So for the last year at high school, I was essentially self-taught from college level textbooks. But to their credit, those two teachers recognized that I'd surpassed them in my ability and knowledge. They didn't get upset about it. They just said, we'll do the best we can to help you and we'll make sure that you get through the exams. It was clear I was going to pass the exams. So in that sense, I was self-taught. But the human comfort of having two teachers who supported me and said, we can't really teach you anymore, but we are all in favor of what you're doing. That provided me with a psychological support because I came from a working class family. My parents were sort of proud of me, but they didn't really understand this idea of going to university rather than going out and getting a job. So those two teachers made a big, big difference. But it was in sort of background support. So apart from that, I was self-taught, which actually stood me instead when I went to graduate school to do research. You're self-guided. You have an advisor, but you're self-guided. So my high school work and my experiences at high school actually prepared me very well for when I was a graduate student and for being an undergraduate as well. I went to a very select undergraduate program at King's College London. They only used to admit 20 or 21 students, and they had to be the best in the United Kingdom. It was very selective back then. Only 3% of students from high school went to university.
So, Keith, you mentioned in your case there were books, science popularization books, the ones that contribute to create this interest in maths. And actually now is one of your roles. You have done amazing research, amazing work in outreach. Yeah. So what was the reason behind it? I want to give back what I got, what I was shown, Keith.
Absolutely. In fact, when I write a book, certainly all my early books, the person I was thinking of was me, age 16. And to a large extent, that's been my ideal reader ever since. Even when I wrote college-level books, when I wrote graduate-level texts, I always tried to make them accessible and understandable and exciting and engaging to a 16-year-old child who actually is interested in mathematics or is potentially interested in mathematics. Because if you can catch someone at that very influential age at 16, that's when someone will decide, I'm going to spend the rest of my life doing this thing. So I'm talking to myself, in a sense, when I write those books.
Have you ever found difficult or challenging to explain a math idea or a math topic in these layman terms?
Actually, no. Some books I've written in as little as 3 weeks, some books I've written in more, some books take a few years, but I've never found it difficult to make it accessible. And I think that's really because of the way I understand mathematics. To me, the only way of understanding mathematics is to reduce it to very simple terms, almost terms that you learn in the kindergarten when you're sort of dealing with piles of sand and so forth. So simple, homely metaphors about sort of jars of oil and mayonnaise and whatever you can do. I try to reduce it to very simple ideas that make sense to me as a human being. And so my outreach work is simply to say, well, what does this mean to me? You know, I did one story once on the radio about gravitational assist when NASA sends up a rocket and then they want to repurpose it and send it somewhere else, and they send it to a planet and then they rotate it round a few times to pick up gravitational acceleration. Then they slingshot it out and they go from place to place. And so to me, the image there is canoeing down a river where it's really hard to change directions if you've got a lot of force in the water. But if you come to a point where two rivers intersect, there's a point in the middle where you can easily go different ways. And so I explain gravitational assist in terms of canoeing on the water, throwing rocks and so forth, because that's how I understood it. To me, understanding means reducing it to simple everyday terms. And until I do that, I don't feel confident in dealing with that mathematics.
Okay, do you think there are faults in the public understanding of maths, of this specific science?
The public really doesn't understand mathematics at all. Their impression of mathematics is totally incorrect. I know where they get it from. They get it from the mathematics they learnt in the school. But that's basically the mathematics that I didn't like either, that didn't make sense to me. Until you go far enough, actually, this is what I'm about to say is no longer necessarily true because of modern technologies. But for most of history, by the time you've left school, if you haven't gone beyond that school mathematics in any way, you're left with an impression of mathematics that's just totally false. It's as if you wanted to sort of learn how to build your own houses. And ultimately, you want to build things, and you go along and they say, well, first of all, you've got to learn how to deal with timber and cut timber up and put timber together, how to lay bricks. So you spend some time learning how to put things together, which you'll need if you want to build a house. But that's not exciting. It's boring. It's the tools of the trade. The reason you do that is so you can then go out and say, well, I'm going to build a house. I'm going to design it. I'm going to make it beautiful. You're really then talking about architecture. To me, mathematics is the architecture part. The mathematics you learn in the elementary schools is the basic learning to lay bricks and brick walls and put timbers together. It's the tools of the trade. And this difference is so huge that there's no wonder that people who don't get beyond that tool stage of learning how to do the basic ingredients of building a house, if they don't get beyond that, they're not going to be. It's all the same. I mean, I mentioned ingredients. It's the same with cooking. If you never get beyond following a recipe and going into the details, and you never get to the point where you say, I think I'll try a little bit of sage in this. And you become creative and you say, this might be good, this might be good. Put a bit of lemon in this. Then it gets exciting, it gets to be fun, and you're creative. The same is true in mathematics. If you don't get to the creative state, you'll never be excited. By the way, I never got to the creative state in cooking. So for me, cooking is largely a chore because I have to go down to the basics and read the recipes.
Keith, before we move into how to find that creative state, maths, that's something that really fascinates me. I want to talk about, because you have choose movies, music, linguistics, in order to share the beauty of maths, yeah, and in order to explain to people the math that is hidden in our everyday lives. So connected to music, last year there was this big story on the news that a mathematician discovered who wrote this famous Beatles song, uh-huh, It's My Life.
Right.
It was Paul McCartney, yeah, or John Lennon. Could you explain that story to us?
Yeah, that was a beautiful one. That's a beautiful one. So, The reason I did a brief piece on the radio, I wrote a blog about it, was because it really did get into the way mathematics and music can sort of interconnect. So the background for that thing is, you know, they didn't know who had written this thing. And there was really no techniques to try to understand that, certainly because Lennon was dead, but both of them left records. It was quite ambiguous as to each of them thought they'd written it. Well, we do have techniques for looking at written language, spam filters, for example, and this was the example that led to the mathematics of solving that. When we get emails, we have these spam filters that filter out the spam. And they do that by looking at the various kinds of words. First of all, they look for words like Viagra and money and things. So they look for obvious keywords, but they also look for the way the words are put together, because spam messages, to do what they do, have a certain kind of structure. And then when you analyze lots of emails, you can find the patterns that spam have, and you can find the patterns that ordinary emails have, and there's actually quite different patterns. It looks at sequences of words and kinds of words and particular words, and you analyze those mathematically. It's just like looking at lots of little graphs, and then you take two messages, you attach all of the graphs, and one is spam and one is not spam. That's how spam filters work. So what the researchers did with this Lennon and McCartney song was they took all of the songs that the two of them had written, some of which were known to be written by Lennon, some of which were known to be written by McCartney. So they said, well, we'll call the McCartney one spam, and we'll call the Lennon one's real email. and we'll run these algorithms. You weren't dealing with words, you were dealing with musical notes. But you could do the same thing. Once you'd made the conversion, you could take all of their songs, represent them in terms of little sequences of notes, and then run the spam filter algorithms and see which one It's My Life came into. And it came into Lennon's. So just as a good spam filter will identify the real email among the spam, the algorithm said, It's My Life is absolutely one of the songs that's in the Lennon packet. It was in the real email packet, and it wasn't in the McCartney packet, which was the spam messages, if you like.
I think that you have a theory about how maths can help better understand Game of Thrones.
Yeah, there's been one or two studies of Game of Thrones. There was one I did a couple of years ago. There was a study. It was actually some undergraduate students at a college somewhere in the Midwest, where they took the mathematics that's used to analyze terrorist cell networks. This is heavy duty stuff. How would you analyze a terrorist cell so you can see who's the leader of the terrorist cell, who the people involved are? And in fact, that's a way they can catch a lot of terrorists by just looking at networks and doing the analysis of the networks, and they know the kind of patterns that terrorist cells have. And so the methods that we use to understand who are the key people, and it has to be done by looking at the mathematical patterns of the networks. Some students in the United States about 2 or 3 years ago applied that to Game of Thrones and said, all of these characters are getting killed off. Who would it be very difficult to kill off without destroying the series? You know, who is the most important person in terms of networks? If you kill that person off, it wouldn't be Game of Thrones, it would be lots of Games of Thrones. And they did the analysis and they came up and they said, this is the person who cannot be killed off. I won't say who it is in case someone hasn't watched the series or not. But the interesting thing from my perspective was that this was a really fun, exciting and engaging way to make people aware of the kind of mathematics that has been done all over the world by security services to protect nations against terrorist attacks. It was developed for doing that kind of thing. Those techniques can be used for all kinds of things like online sales and so forth, but you can apply them to things like TV series. There's actually another study that was completed fairly recently, I think, where a group of researchers in Australia used the mathematics of epidemiology and about the spreads of diseases and applied that to Game of Thrones to see how the various plot lines could develop and how things could sort of spread out amongst the various cast members. And again, the nice part about this is it shows that mathematics really can apply everywhere. If you can apply it at the two extremes, life and death and entertainment, you can apply it anywhere in between.
Another connection that really shocked me is the similarities between Fibonacci and Steve Jobs.
Yeah, that was a revelation to me. I was working for several years on a history of Fibonacci, the beginning of the modern world, because it was Fibonacci, Leonardo of Pisa, in the 13th century. He wrote a book that really created the modern Western world. It took the idea of Hindu-Arabic arithmetic that was developed in India in the 6th or 7th centuries, 1st, 6th or 7th century current era. That was taken by the Arabic Persian-speaking traders going up and down the Silk Route. They took that method of Hindu-Arabic arithmetic with 10 digits, the modern kinds of mathematics, used it in their trading. They extended it. They introduced something that we now call algebra, coming from the Arabic term algebra. Fibonacci, as a young man, 17 or 18, travels to visit his father, who'd gone from Pisa to North Africa to represent the Pisan traders and deal with Mediterranean trading, sees them using this thing and says, wow, this is huge. This can change the world. And so when he goes back to Italy in his early 20s, goes back to Pisa, he writes this mammoth book explaining in great detail how to do this new kind of arithmetic, how to do arithmetic with 10 digits, place value with a zero, the way we all know about doing arithmetic today. He introduced it to the Western world in the beginning of the 13th century. And within a few decades, we have the beginning of banking, insurance, international trading conglomerates, modern legal systems. All of that comes out of Tuscany in the beginning of the 13th century. And the spark that lit it and the fuel that kept the fire ignited for this revolution was Hindu-Arabic arithmetic. So he completely changed the world in the 13th century. He also wrote a lot of other popular books on mathematics, which is why I was interested in him. He was a popularizer, and so I saw him as one of the people that spent a lot of his time doing something that I'd spent a lot of my career doing. So I'd always wanted to write a history book about him. And about the year 2000, just after I came back to Stanford, I said, I'm going to do this book now. I'm going to write this book. I would get on a plane in San Francisco, Silicon Valley, and I'd land in usually into Pisa. I'm in this sort of 13th century world, thinking about Fibonacci and what he did and knowing the history of Fibonacci. And after 2 or 3 years of doing this, I suddenly thought, this is the Silicon Valley Revolution 800 years earlier. The story was exactly the same. So at some point, I actually got off my shelf books about Silicon Valley. I got off Stephen Levy's book, Insanely Great, about the invention of the Macintosh. I read that. I read other books about the invention of the Macintosh and the PC. And I went through and compared those accounts of Silicon Valley in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, really the 80s and 90s. I read those stories. And I compared them with all my research on Fibonacci. And it wasn't just vaguely similar. It was step one was the same, step two was the same, step three. It was exactly the same story. And I said, let's just make this personal. We'll take Steve Jobs, because he was the one that took personal computing. He didn't invent it. He didn't really invent anything. He was the one who made it a consumer product. Fibonacci in the 13th century took something that somebody else invented, modern arithmetic, and made it a consumer product. He explained it and provided it in a way, presented it in a way that meant ordinary people could use it. Hence, there was a revolution in computing in your head and on paper. Steve Jobs did the same with the Macintosh. The similarity between those two stories is completely uncanny. You know, those of us in Silicon Valley like to think of ourselves as doing something really new. No, it was all done in the 13th century to the last detail. Except in the 13th century, you were doing it so that people could do it in their heads as the computing device. Today, we do it so that people can use it using silicon chips in a device. But it's the same story.
So, Keith, the last example that I would like you to share with us. Actually, in this case, I want you to debunk or not myth of the golden ratio. It's been said that behind the Parthenon, behind the pyramids, even behind the Apple logo, is this mathematical idea. It's kind of the golden ratio is it's the beauty, what gives beauty to the art world. Is that true or not?
No, it's complete nonsense, which is why I sort of exploded when I heard you say this. It's one of these stories that's sort of got a life of its own. It was actually, that story about the golden ratio and beauty was invented in the 19th century by an early German science popularizer who discovered he could sell books by making up these stories linking beauty, God, divinity, and mathematics, and picked on this thing called the golden ratio. And this whole myth just grew out from that, and it's got legs of its own. I and several other mathematicians for 15 or 20 years have been trying really hard to sort of counter that and say, no, this is complete nonsense. It's complete nonsense on several levels, not the least because the golden ratio is actually not one whole number divided by another. It's not a ratio at all in that sense. So if you do build something and you build it according to some proportions, it could not possibly be the golden ratio because the golden ratio is what we call an irrational number. It doesn't work that way. But be that as it may, if you want to make claims about the golden ratio being in art and music and so forth, you have to provide evidence. You can't just make a claim without evidence. We're talking science, not religious beliefs here. And no one's provided any evidence, and there's actually plenty of evidence against it. One of the exercises I used to do with students for many years was going to a class, a math class. I used to do a lot of math classes for non-science majors, which were always filled with artists and people like that. And I used to like teaching them. So I'd go in with a piece of paper on which were drawn with a computer a whole array of rectangles. Of different aspect ratios. And I said, have you all heard this story about the golden ratio? And I said, oh yes, I know about the golden ratio. Tell me what you've heard about it. Oh, it's in artwork. It's the most beautiful rectangle. So I said, okay, this is the most beautiful rectangle. You're artists. You have a good aesthetic sense. You're going to go through this page and tick, mark off the one that's the golden ratio, the one you find the most pleasing. Which rectangle do you find the most aesthetically pleasing? The one of the rectangles that no one ever picks is the golden ratio. It's not attractive. People don't find it attractive. They find it slightly too wide, but not wide enough. It's not 4:3, it's not 16:9, it's something else, and it's not attractive. So a simple experiment will tell us it's not the most pleasing rectangle. It may have been the most pleasing rectangle at some time, and indeed the Parthenon is fairly close to the golden ratio, because it's, the golden ratio is just slightly more than 1.5. And so lots of things are sort of 3:2. For example, Leonardo da Vinci, lots of his drawings, he used 3:2. It's a very nice ratio. But the golden ratio is close, and close enough maybe, but not exact. So if you want to make a claim about the golden ratio, you have to have some evidence as to why that particular number is important. If it's important simply because it's close to 1.5, well, go with 1.5. It's the simplest explanation of why people find things attractive. So there's no evidence for it, but there is a lot to be said about the golden ratio. It does arise a lot in the natural world. If you go into the garden, you will see the golden ratio and the associated Fibonacci numbers all over. The golden ratio is an important number in its own right. It's an interesting number mathematically, and it does connect with nature in terms of things growing. What it doesn't connect with is people's sense of aesthetics and beauty. There's a few cases where people have explicitly used it. In architecture and in music. But that's because they deliberately tried to put it in. Debussy, we think, and there's some evidence to support this, quite deliberately tried to embed the golden ratio in some of his music. One or two painters tried to do that. But they did it deliberately, not because it was the aesthetic, but because it was an interesting number mathematically. Mathematicians like the golden ratio because it's interesting mathematically. It certainly occurs all the time in the growing world of plants and flowers and so forth. Does it occur in human aesthetics, human architecture? Only if people deliberately put it in, and it's certainly not because we've got some innate sense of beauty that the golden ratio we find attractive. In fact, the rectangle that people typically find the most attractive is the one that they're most familiar with, which is usually the shape of the television screen or the computer screen or the iPad or the iPhone or anything. Those rectangles that we spend a lot of time with, those are the ones we find the most attractive. So it's possible that in the ancient Greek times, because of the way they put buildings up, most buildings were close to the golden ratio. But there's absolutely not a shred of evidence that the architects of the Parthenon or anything else made explicit use of that. And if you go back to the pyramids, there's no evidence that anyone in those days even knew about the golden ratio. It just wasn't known. As far as we know, it was invented by the Greeks around 300 BC as a simple solution to a quadratic equation, that's all.
So, Keith, I would like to, all these examples are great, and obviously they help in creating this interest towards maths that is so much needed. Actually, there is a badge of honor in recognizing that you are not good at maths. But you have mentioned before this beautiful idea of that's because the way we teach math at a school doesn't help to reach that creative state that helped me develop or nurture this love for maths. So what would be your advice to students or to guide the students to reach that place or state of mind?
Well, now we're living in a very different world because of technology. So my advice now is don't listen to your parents. They lived in a different world where mathematics was done differently by the professionals, had to be taught differently, had to be learned differently. Mathematics was unchanged for thousands of years. To get into mathematics, you had to be good at arithmetic, you had to be good at algebra, you had to learn to do all of these procedural algorithmic calculations. That was the route in. If you didn't pass all of the courses in those basics, you could never get beyond that. There was the only way in. And the reason was we had no machinery, no devices, no technologies to do those things for us. In the 1960s, we began to get electronic calculators, digital calculators. And then throughout the 60s, 70s, and into the 80s, we got more sophisticated technologies so that by around the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, all of the mathematics which was taught up to a first degree, to get any degree in mathematics, all of that mathematics has been automated. It was available. You can do it on your smartphone in the cloud now. We had machines to do all of that. So just as when the automobile was invented, nobody needed to know how to look after a horse, feed a horse, groom the horse, make sure it's in good health, learn how to ride a horse. Automobiles came along, horses are gone. You just learned how to drive. And you didn't even have to learn how to build or maintain an automobile because there were experts to do that. The same happened in mathematics at the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s. Technologies became available to do all of the calculations, the algebra, the calculus, the probability, everything, the whole thing, all of the procedural stuff. Basically, if mathematics, if something in mathematics involves do step one, step two, step three, it's now done by computers. That means to become a mathematician, you don't have to master calculation to get into there because you've got the tools to do it. What you have to learn now is how to use those tools. The way I usually like to describe it is in terms of music. Again, one of my favorite analogies. For many, many generations, being a mathematician was like learning to play in an orchestra. You had to learn to play the violin, the piano, the cello, the drums. The more instruments you could play, the better mathematicians. The instruments were arithmetic, algebra, trigonometry, geometry, calculus, probability theory, differential equations. All these things were like instruments in the orchestra. Since the beginning of the 90s, being a mathematician is like being the conductor of an orchestra. You don't have to play any of the instruments. You have to understand them. A conductor has to know what each instrument can do, what its limitations are, how to bring them together, how to make sure that they come together to form a nice coherent sound. So there's a lot of musical skill required to be a conductor. But to be a conductor, you don't need to be a master of all the instruments. Mathematics is like that now. No one does any of the calculations in mathematics themselves anymore. Machines do that. When you're a mathematician today, you're conducting this wonderful orchestra of instruments. Now, the conductor will have to learn one or two instruments in order to be in that position. You can't just get away and go and become a conductor. You have to get a deep understanding of music. The same is true of mathematics. So to become a mathematician today, you certainly have to learn arithmetic for sure, a little bit of algebra maybe, but not that much. Because the machines do all of the calculations, humans don't need to be good at doing that. We don't have to learn, we don't have to train our mind to be a calculator. And that's boring. You know, one of the reasons people don't like it is doing calculations is boring. It's do this step, do that step. That's as far away from creativity as you can get. Human beings are innately creative. Of course we don't like step one, step two, step three. We put up with it for as long as we have to get where we want to go. But the world has changed now. You don't have to channel yourself that way. You simply have to be creative and say, I want to be able to do this. Okay, well, this needs something called calculus. This needs something called trigonometry. Oh, there's this trigonometry package on my computer. There's this calculus package. Let me find out enough about those packages to bring them together and do something.
Can you have created games in order to help teach maths? You say that they are a good tool for learning maths. Tell me more about that.
Yeah, I actually, way back when, back in the UK, when my children were just in school age, that was when personal computers were just beginning to come out in the, I guess it was the early 1980s. But I actually wrote a couple of simple math games because I thought, hey, this is kind of interesting. Let's see if I can present some little geometry games for my kids. And my two kids, my two daughters, both of whom were keen students, they were scholastic, they read a lot, they worked hard. They were completely enraptured by these video games. They would play these games for hours. And I knew then, I thought, yeah, I've made these two little trivial video games, but if I was able to go into this world and create good video games about real mathematics, not sort of little bits of mathematics, but serious mathematics, given the degree of engagement, that's just it's a home run for learning mathematics, a subject that is difficult. If you can turn some difficult mathematics into a challenging, engaging video game, then you're 90% of the way to getting kids to learn mathematics. Supposing you want to go to school, you wanted to learn music, you wanted to learn to play the piano or something, and the piano teacher or the guitar teacher says, well, first of all, you have to learn this musical notation. We're going to spend a whole semester learning how to read and write music. And then we're going to spend a whole semester just practicing scales on the piano or on the guitar. And then when you've learned all of the basics, then we'll let you play some music. not many people would become musicians. That sounds boring and tedious, but that also sounds like the math class. Come and we'll learn how to do arithmetic, then how to do geometry, learn how to do trigonometry, etc. When you've learnt all of that, then you can put it together to do all of this fun stuff that's around there. No wonder people don't like it. So we design our games to be the equivalent of instruments. Why do instruments work? Because first of all, you feel the music, you hear it, you interact with it physically. So you're actually into the music, and the music has reality embodied in everything you do. It's embodied music. So it provides direct access to it. You're not getting into the music through the score. You might have a musical score on the back of the piano, or the guitarist might have a score down here, but they're just glancing at that. They're really feeling the music. So we design these instruments. So yes, you may want to sort of write some formulas down somewhere, but to actually solve these math problems, you're engaging with the instrument, just like a guitarist would be playing the guitar, a pianist would be playing the piano. And so we now have games. The first one was to do integer arithmetic, whole number arithmetic, as if it was an instrument. We built, with this grant we got, we built an instrument for doing fractions. We built another instrument for doing algebraic equations. We're about to build some more equations to do some estimation and things. But the model we have, the design principle, is a musical instrument. What does it take to make a musical instrument successful? It has to have an interface that feels natural and that allows you to feel the music. When you hit the piano keys, you feel the music. You can, if it's a real piano, you can even get the vibrations from the thing. People talk about playing the piano. They don't talk about working with the piano or solving the piano. They're playing with it. Even though they're working very hard, they're playing with it. We talk about playing video games. We want to talk about playing math video games. It needs to be play, both in the sense of a performance and in the sense of play as pleasurable activity. You can do that with games.
Kids, besides games, what other digital tools that you think are useful for young people, for kids, even for adults, to learn maths?
The tool that I use, first of all, is Google. Google is the most powerful tool in the world for doing anything. If I have a problem that's about something that I, you know, because I've been in the business a long time, lots of problems I meet, and I've done a lot of applied work for the US Department of Defense and for industry. And so typically these are different kinds of problems that I'm not familiar with. But sometimes I can look at a problem and say, oh yeah, I know how to do this kind of thing. But quite often I don't. So the first thing I do is I've got this problem, and this happened when I was working for the Defense Department and a whole bunch of these projects. You look at the problem that they specify, and I just go onto Google and enter keywords. And very quickly, I'll come up with keywords. Well, I'll get some references to some recent research, to some papers. I very often limit the research on Google to the last 5 years, and I just find out what's been published. And then very quickly can go and teach myself. When I do that, I find some other terms that I need to Google to understand. Eventually, I need to find a little bit more, so I use Wikipedia to find descriptions of these terms. I go to YouTube to find little... Nowadays, if you want to learn any mathematics, There's a YouTube video for it. You just have to learn the name of the thing. You find out it's something called, oh, it's linear programming. So you go onto YouTube and you type in linear programming. There were 50 videos come up. You know, sometimes it's Khan Academy, sometimes it's others. So you can look at a little 15-minute, 20-minute video. You can get a general idea of it. You can play around with it. All of these search tools, starting with Google, then looking at Wikipedia, looking at YouTube, and then there are more sophisticated tools for doing mathematics. If I need to do calculations, I use a thing called Wolfram Alpha, which I like because it's got a very simple interface. Wolfram Alpha does for mathematics what Google does for documents. Google allows you to search on terms to find documents or images. Wolfram Alpha allows you to search on mathematical problems. It has a simple interface. You just enter something in the interface. Wolfram Alpha doesn't just find the method. It runs it for you. It gives you the answer. It solves the problem. You put the problem in and the answer comes out instantaneously. So very quickly, I can get to the stage of solving that problem and then submitting a report. It's all there, and it's using tools. It's conducting that orchestra I was talking about.
I'm loving this idea that because we have these tools, we can stop making many mental calculations. Mm-hmm. But I have a question. I mean, what are the maths that we cannot, let's put it this way, give up on them, that we still need them in order to navigate a future that is completely unknown?
Okay, I'm going to be somewhat radical now. This isn't my idea. This is an idea that's been around for several decades. If you develop arithmetic in the right way, and the only thing kids learn throughout the school system is arithmetic, but you learn it deeper, in a more deeply understanding way, and you get further and further into it and understand arithmetic in a really deep way, at that point, it's very easy to go to the side and learn trigonometry or geometry. In other words, if you learn arithmetic the right way, you can actually go to the web using Google, using Wikipedia, using YouTube, and teach yourself anything new. And the reason that's important is because the kinds of mathematics that get used in today's world are changing so rapidly with technology and with society changing that whatever you teach in the school, that particular mathematics is probably not going to be relevant. It's going to be something else. So the skill to using mathematics today is to do two things. You get a problem, and this is, doesn't matter if you're an engineer or whatever, if you're in the world, your problem comes along, you have to first of all, using Google or whatever, find which branch of mathematics is most suited to that. Almost certainly, it might be something that wasn't even in existence when you were at school, and then teach yourself using the resources. If you've learned arithmetic sufficiently well for several years and you've gone into it deeply, you have learned all of the skills to do mathematics that you need in these other disciplines. It's as if you learned to paint a house and you paint a house white and then you paint it again white and several years you learned to paint the house, but you always paint it white, but you do it in more detail, you're more careful, you avoid getting paint on the windows, you get better at doing it, but you're painting the house white. Supposing then you get married or you get remarried and your new spouse says, I want the house to be blue. All you do is go and buy blue paint and apply the skills you've got. Mathematics is like that.
A message that I'm getting from you, and actually it's something that you have addressed in some of your books, is that math is not necessarily about solving an equation or a problem, but creating a way of thinking that you can apply to different aspects, right? So there is this mathematical thinking versus doing maths.
Right, yeah, yeah. The reason I started using this word mathematical thinking, I actually gave the world's first mathematics MOOC when they came out of Stanford here in 2012, and I called it Introduction to Mathematical Thinking. And the reason I called it that rather than mathematics was to emphasize that this course, like all of mathematics today as it's done in the world, is about a way of thinking. It's just a way of thinking about the world. And the world we're thinking about could be the world of mathematics itself. When mathematics is applied to itself, we call it pure mathematics. When it's applied to the world, we call it applied mathematics. But it's essentially the same stuff. But it's a way of thinking. Now, for thousands of years, when the only way to become a mathematician was to learn how to calculate, and when you were doing mathematics and you had to do calculations, you literally had to do them. So most of what mathematicians did throughout history, most of the time, was spent doing calculations. Most of the time in the math class was learnt doing calculations. So over the centuries, people began to think mathematics is calculations. That would be the same as saying architecture is about bricklaying, because eventually you have to pour concrete and put bricks down, but of course it's not. It's about all of the creativity and the design of the building and the understanding of people using buildings. But you have to spend the reality is the designer of a building may spend a few months designing it. The people building it will spend months or years physically building it. So even with architecture, most of the time is spent building with the details, when the design is a fun start. That was true throughout history with mathematics. So not surprisingly, when we hear the word mathematics today, we think about people writing formulas and solving equations, because for thousands of years, that was what you spent most of the time doing. Now, during that period, the actual mathematicians knew that that wasn't what it was about. That was just the tool they had to use. They had to use their own brains to do the calculations, to develop the thinking, to understand what was correct, what wasn't correct, to get answers to questions. But they knew that the mathematics was about thinking. But most of their students and the students in the schools didn't know that, because they didn't get beyond the calculations to the creative thinking. So most people have no idea that what they do in mathematics class is just the mechanics. For thousands of years, we had to say, that's too bad, because that's the only way you can become a mathematician anyway. You have to learn that stuff. That's no longer the case. Since the end of the 90s, machines do that. So there's really no need to spend a lot of time in the math class mastering all of those algorithms. we can concentrate on the other stuff. But knowing that the word mathematics conjures up using formulas, I explicitly, and so did some colleagues of mine, started using the word mathematical thinking to say, no, this is about thinking, and we're going to focus on that. Doing mathematics today is conducting a technological orchestra with all of the skills that requires and all of the creativity that involves and all of the fun that entails.
Keith, thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure, absolutely.